First of all, I wanted to thank everyone for coming. It's a cold evening. Everyone came out to hear some Divrei Torah, to honor very honorable people, and of course to enjoy some Chinesische cuisine. And the rabbi told me not to thank everyone, because everyone that needs to be thanked, that'll be done later by different people. But I did want to mention just quickly someone that I don't think will be thanked later, and that is the two most important people in our shul, and that's Rabbi and Rebbetzin Shapiro. I'm sorry, I said turn off the cell phones. So anyway, the rabbi and the Rebbetzin have opened up their homes, their shul. Now it's a Bais Medrash, and they've opened up their homes throughout the year for us to daven and to eat shalosh shudis. And the rabbi and the Rebbetzin do a tremendous job, spending all of their spare time, which they don't have, answering questions. The rabbi stays after shul, and the Rebbetzin watches everyone's children. And it's a very special, a special environment that we have throughout the year. And especially in the aftermath of the storm, the Shapiro household became, right immediately after in the aftermath, it became a place where they really, really opened their homes, not just for people to daven, but for people to eat and to get a warm place to go. And I think there was a very special feeling right after the storm, where our community felt like they could come together, especially in this shul. And we thank you all for coming tonight to honor the shul and the rabbi and the Rebbetzin, but really also for the special heroes that we've had in our community. And I'm not going to thank them and talk about them, because the rabbi will. The other amazing thing about in Rabbi Shapiro's shul, in other shuls, people get used to, the rabbi gets up and people fall asleep and they start talking. But in our shul, we're used to a very dynamic speaker, where the rabbi gets up and everyone is enthralled and are interested, not for just for the entertainment value, but for the interesting thoughts and the interesting learning that they get when they hear the rabbi speak. I do want to ask everyone, if you're not used to this kind of speaking style, where we actually listen, I made actually a sign to remind everyone to please be quiet. It just says, please be quiet in Hebrew. I don't know if you could see. It's just, yeah. So instead of shushing people, I'll just hold up the sign. And if that's insufficient, we have, we've brought an armed police squad. I'm just kidding. Anyways, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our Mora D'Asser, the leader of our community, Rabbi Shapiro.
Shikayach, we're planning on having a very full evening, and we know that we're all here to honor the Shomrim. But besides the Shomrim, we have other people that we're honoring tonight at the Shul's Melave Malka. The honorees don't even know at this point in time that they're being honored. We do this every year. We don't want to honor people by telling them they're being honored and come, because when you do that, they'll think that the reason why you're honoring them is the same reason why they get honored in other places. Because why? Because they'll bring in money. In our Shul, Baruch Hashem, we don't honor people because we want them to give something to us. We honor people because we want to give something to them. And so the people who are being honored, everybody knows about the Shomrim tonight. And 50% of the profits from tonight's event will be donated to the Shomrim. But besides that, we have other people also who we're honoring, and at this point in time, they don't know that they're being honored. I'm going to mention the first one right now, but first, a little hakdama. There are many mitzvahs that people do. Shomrim, for example, others, many great things that people do. But the greatest thing that anybody could do is learning the Torah HaKadosha. One word of learning Torah HaKadosha has more Kedusha than the entire body of all 613 mitzvahs. And even if you do all 613 mitzvahs an entire lifetime, it doesn't come close to the Kedusha of one word of learning Torah. And our first honoree is being honored because not that he is a community askin, and not that he donates a lot of money anywhere. Those people deserve to be honored too. But before, above and beyond all of those people, the people that deserve more to be honored than anybody else are the people that come to every shir, the people that ask questions, the people that Shavuos nights come to shul and stay up a whole night without falling asleep, the people that come and open up a sefer and learn, because those are the people that keep our community, our world running. In this week's parsha, it says that the Jews did not listen to Moshe Rabbeinu when he told them that he's bringing them out of Egypt because they had koitzer ruach v'avoy dekasha. And the Chazal ask, who in the world would not listen when you tell them they're being freed from slavery? And it says the Jews did not listen because they were busy with avodah zarah. They were idol worshippers. And because they were idol worshippers, they didn't want to leave Egypt. And the question the Mefarshim ask, the Divrei Yoel asks it, and others as well, is that whenever you have a Pshutei Shel Mikra is avodah kasha, koitzer ruach. Never, ever do you find that Chazal just changed the explanation of a pasuk without fitting it into the pasuk itself. And how do we understand this in light of what the pasuk says? I want to answer the question. And the answer is that we see this every day. Avoid the kosher, koitzer ruach. How do we live our lives every day? Let me tell you how we live our lives. We wake up early in the morning. Let's say somebody wakes up 6 o'clock in the morning. He has to rush to pick up the A train because otherwise he's going to be late to work. And he spends an hour and a half on the A train going to work, and he works hard for some boss that doesn't appreciate him, and for some business where he's just spinning his wheels, for some company that he doesn't appreciate him at all. And then he has to run back to the train, has to chop a little mincha, a couple of minutes in between. He has to chop a shachris, chop a mincha, run back to the train. He gets home, what, 8 o'clock at night. He's able to fit in a little learning, and he has to go to sleep early. Maybe he'll be able to see his kids. He has to go to sleep early in order to wake up early in order to chop the train again. For what? And what does he have from all this? He's able to pay his mortgage, to have a house. And what is he going to do with the house? He has a backyard. How many times was he ever in his backyard? I asked somebody today, how many times were you ever in your backyard? He has a nice big backyard. How many times were you ever in it? Well, I really don't have time, you know. We live crazy lives. We live crazy lives. Is this a life? Is this what Hashem put us on the world for? To run around like chickens without heads. Every day from morning to night, running around, coming home. How much time do people have to spend with their kids? How much time do people have to be Yoyver Hashem? These are normal lives. These are not normal lives. But we think this is normal lives. We think that somebody who's successful and somebody who works hard and makes a lot of money and builds bigger and better house and has a fancier and newer car, that's called success. That's not called success. That's called slavery. You know, whenever I pass by some neighborhoods, you know, I go through some places in back of Far Rockaway or in Auburn or something, I make a bracha, baruch atah Hashem, alakeinu melech haolam, shlo yasani, right? Then when I go through some other neighborhoods and I see some people with fancy big houses and fancy cars, I make a bracha with even bigger kavana. Baruch atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech Olam Shlo Yasani Oved. This is Avdus. Now, if you come to one of these people and you tell them, I'm taking you out of here, I'm freeing you. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to stay in the Midbar 40 years straight, and we're going to eat the man, and we're going to learn Torah day and night. Would you do it? Well, am I going to have my fancy car? Am I going to have my fancy house? That's not a life. 40 years to learn in Kollel. I don't understand. Who's going to support us? What are you going to contribute to society? In the desert? What do you have? You have to be a light unto the nations. Don't ask me where people got that crazy idea from. You got to be a light unto the nations. And how are we going to be a light unto the nations if we're in the desert, wandering for 40 years? The Kollel system, what do you mean? Going to sit in Kvetcha Bank for 40 years and do nothing? And just learn and eat the man? Ain't Samchen al Hanes. Moshe Rabbeinu came to them and told them, I'm freeing you. And they do it. They say, we should be free. We're here in Egypt. Egypt is the world's power. We're working for the biggest company in the world. Yes, we work hard. It's true. But at least we're appreciated over here. Somebody asked us, what do you do for a living? I work for Paroi. Can you find a bigger company than Paroi? Yes, they have to work hard. And yes, some of them get killed. And people get heart attacks from working every day. But it doesn't matter. By them, this was a normal life. Because they were oivdei avodah zarah, they were unable to understand what's a normal life and what's a crazy life. Because they were oivdei avodah zarah and they didn't have a Torah cup, they understood that avodah kasha and kotzer ruach is normal. That's a good thing. They wanted avodah kasha and kotzer ruach. Isn't that what we all have today? If somebody told us that they're taking us out of Bayswater and bringing us 40 years into the desert to learn Torah Yom Valayla, that the moon is going to come down and that there's going to be a Bar Miriam, how many people would take the opportunity to learn in Kollel straight for 40 years? And how many people would be against it? And how many people write on the internet what a terrible idea it is? And how many people would run around saying that, no, Chas V'Sholem, we can't do that, and the Rambam didn't believe in Shadim, and therefore we shouldn't go out of our Avdus. The Jews, because they were Oivdei Avodah Zarah, they didn't understand that Avodah Kasha and Kotzer Ruach is crazy. They didn't understand their lives are nuts. They thought they had a normal life. And in those days it was a normal life. There are some people that understand what a normal life is and what a crazy life is. I want to tell you something. Our first honoree, he's going to be shocked. Bais Medrash of Bayswater presents the Ahavas HaTorah Award, and this is for somebody that understands what normal is and what crazy is. When we were kids, what did we do with our spare time? Read comic books about cosmic fiery birds or something that end up in space. What did we do when we were kids? What did we play? Here's somebody who comes to the Bais Medrash on his spare time, Shabbos afternoon, who comes and learns and comes to every shiur and asks questions, Mamish Kechod Halamdonim. Rafi Weiss, you are our first honoree. Come get your award. This boy over here, this Rafi Weiss, he deserves our honor. He is a role model for us. He is somebody who deserves to be honored in the biggest congregations in the world. Why? No, he doesn't give a lot of money to our shul. He comes and eats shalosh shulis for free sometimes. He doesn't give a penny, and that's all fine. But every lecture, every shir he comes to, if he's available, Shavuos night, he sits there straight. He doesn't go to sleep. He sits there, but not just learning. He's asking questions and kashas, and I don't understand this, and I want to know this, and can you please explain to me this? And he's there amongst people that are old enough to be his father and even his grandfather, and he's sitting there, and he's participating, mamish kechad min halam donim, and this is what we need to encourage more than anything else in the world. Rafi, here, please take your award. It says, Bais Medrash of Bayswater. See, we got a picture of you. This was a conspiracy. Presents a Havas HaTorah to Rafi Weiss. May you go Michael al Choyel and continue to be a tremendous nachas to Hashem and to your parents and all the members of our Bais Medrash, because we are all inspired by you. You want to say thank you? No? Okay, there you go. Thank you very much. That is what you call a real honoree, guys. That's a real honoree. He deserves to be honored. And now please enjoy your first course. And afterwards, we'll continue giving the awards to other honorees. Our next honoree, call him up right away, Moishe Klein. Come here, Moishe. I want to tell you a little about Moishe Klein, and then comes the Dvar Torah. Listen. Let me read you this. This is the pras. Come, Moishe, here. This way. Here's your award. Matches your dining room, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Pras, same style too. See the, okay. Pras Goyel Choshech Mipneyor, presented to Mr. and Mrs. Moishe Klein. Listen to what it says. Shh. For giving us light when we had only darkness. For giving us warmth when we were cold. For single-handedly doing more to repair our shattered neighborhood than we dared hope could ever be done. With everlasting gratitude, Bais Medrash of Bayswater. Take it. Do you want to say something?
No.
Okay. Now.
No.
Okay. That's fine. Now. You got him? Picture? Got him? Okay. Now, I want to explain something at this point. I want to explain a little about Moishe Klein and then a little about the group that he comes from. Okay. Moishe Klein. Guys. I'm waiting. Moishe Klein neglected his own welfare, his own home, which we all saw videos of Niagara Falls coming in over there, in order to help people in our neighborhood. He's a very active member of the Shomrim, but besides that, during the storm, he was busy day and night fixing people's electricity, putting in people's generators. For 3 weeks into the hurricane, he went out every night to help people in Far Rockaway, to make sure the people who had, people didn't have power. He went out to make sure they had power. Every day for 3 weeks into the storm. But it's not only that. Moishe Klein, I didn't call. One day, I was here during the storm. I was here the whole time. I stayed home. We were here during the storm. Lights went out, everybody knows, for 2 weeks. What are we going to do for lights? We were cold. We had no heat. We had no lights. We didn't call Moishe Klein and ask for help. We got batteries and flashlights and down blankets, and that's how we lived. And one day, Moishe Klein pulls up with this big generator to my house, and he hooks it up to my electric circuitry. And it's not only I thought I was a choshev guy, that Moishe Klein comes and hooks up my generator, but I learned that I'm not so choshev. He did the same thing for tons and tons and tons of people. But you should know that Moishe Klein, his generator hooking ups and unhooking ups and returning them where they came from and getting them from where they're supposed to be and going around from house to house, making sure people have what they have. This is not a yoytze min haklal for him. I want to tell you something. All his life, he was known for people that know him well, for his generosity, his chesed, and his helping others. When he was, listen, Captain, listen to the story. When he was just getting married, when he was engaged, okay? You know, an engaged guy, look at him. He looks like he has a lot of, he'd be very busy, right? Engaged guy, look at him, right? He's off the market. But when he was engaged, he had a friend who, unfortunately, his friend was dying of cancer. You think that he was busy going out with his fiancée? He spent all the time in the hospital taking care of his friend, spending his own money, buying him CDs and various things and going to the hospital. And it was known far and wide. He doesn't know I know this story. I heard it from, you know, the grapevine. But it's that, and I told somebody that Moishe Klein is getting honored tonight, his father-in-law. I told him secretly, you know. And he says, I walked into his store and I told him what he was doing for the neighborhood. And you know what your father-in-law told me? He says, Moishe, not he's a Baal Chesed, not he does for people. His whole essence, he said in Yiddish, of course, I'm translating. His whole essence is pure and unadulterated Chesed. That's all he is. And I have to tell you something. I would be doing a great injustice to our community if I wouldn't mention the other half of the equation here. You know, the Gemara says, Rabbi Akiva, the great sage, got married and then left to learn Torah for 12 years. He came back to his wife 12 years later after he became a great sage, and he wanted to greet his wife and to tell her that I'm back. I finished my scholastics. Now I'm a big sage. And he heard his wife. He overheard her telling somebody. Somebody asked her, do you really, really, really appreciate? Do you understand? Do you tolerate? Do you like the fact that your husband was out becoming a great scholar for 12 years? And you know what she said? If he would go for another 12 years, I would really appreciate it. He turned around and went back for another 12 years. Now, even though Moishe was not missing from his home for 24 years, nevertheless, a tremendous amount of time he did spend taking care of our neighborhood. And without his wife, without her support, without her understanding, without her appreciation for what her husband is doing, it never would have been able to happen. She deserves, I want to say half, I want to say all, whatever it is, for encouraging him, he says all, for encouraging him, for appreciating him, and for not just allowing, for helping him and strengthening him in his efforts to help our community. We owe Mr. and Mrs. Moishe Klein our undying, everlasting gratitude. You know what it is to have to move out of the neighborhood with your kids because your house is in a shambles, because you bought a nice, really modern-looking house right across the street from the bay, and suddenly a storm comes, floods your basement, your husband's busy taking videos of the water coming in, okay, and you have to move out of the house so your husband can go around generator hopping from house to house. Do you understand what sacrifice that is? She deserves a tremendous amount of credit. And now there's something I want to say. I want to answer a question, as long as we're on the topic of Moshe Klein and his group over here. I want to answer a question that I was asked by people in the community, and many people were asked. Now, I don't want anybody to get me wrong. There are plenty of people that helped the community during the aftermath of the hurricane. No question about it. But there are certain people. Guys, please. There are certain people that shone, that stood out. And there are certain groups that stood out. The Bayswater community, everybody knows, stood out head and shoulders above many other communities, much more affluent than us. And that's not to take away from the great efforts that people in Lawrence and Cedarhurst and the five towns put in. But as a group, Bayswater was amazing. And within Bayswater, there was a group of people. And again, it's not to take away and not to diminish the fact that there are many, 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 many people that helped in the aftermath of the hurricane. But there was a subgroup that is affectionately known in our neighborhood as, quote, these Hasidish guys. That, and not only our neighborhood, Monroe, Borough Park, people came, these guys came from far and wide. We had, I'm not exaggerating, we had a fire engine parked in front of the Young Israel from these guys, a command center. There's a slideshow of the aftermath of the hurricane going on by the entrance now. We have pictures of these Hasidish guys chopping food. Now, again, doesn't take away from the other people that did. Plenty of people did. But as a group, these people stood out, and I'm going to explain why. I'm going to explain now why. Please tell them to hold up whatever they're doing. Please tell them to postpone, hold whatever they're doing for 10 minutes. Just hold up. That's it. Okay. Shh. I'm going to explain now why these Hasidish guys, and not only these, why these people are known far and wide for their chesed as a group. People think it's because the Heilige Rebbe Zeichet Tzadik LeBracha trains them to do chesed. And to an extent, of course, that's true. In Satmar, when yeshiva, in the Litvish yeshivas, there's no such thing. But in Satmar, the yeshiva, Erev Shabbos, Erev Pesach, part of the curriculum was that the Bocharim, the Talmidim, would go and do chesedim. And the Rebbe once said, the Rebbetzin needed a bikacholim, it was Erev Pesach, and they couldn't find Bocharim, and the Rebbe said, if you can't find Bocharim Erev Pesach to do Bika Cholim, I close down my whole yeshiva. And that's true, but there's more to it than that. There's much more to it. There's something called a Yiddish Neshama. And a Yiddish Neshama has its own Yiddish personality. Every group, every ethnic group has their personality. And the Yiddish Neshama has a Yiddish personality. Rachmonim Baishonim Ugoim Leichasodim. There are some areas where the nishama of a Yisrael has bigger nisyonis than other people. Hashem wants people to have certain nisyonis, and he gives them a personality with nisyonis because he wants them to fight the nisyonis and to get reward. There are certain areas where it's more difficult for the nishama of a Yisrael to come through and to be oimid b'nisoyin, then another neshama. There are nisyonis, there's no question about it. In shul, we discussed it many times. There's a vote from Rav Hutner on this, is not for now. But there are times, there are other places where the neshama of a Yisrael has a special natural netiya towards chesed. The Rambam says that Kol mi she'ein loy rachmonus, somebody who has no rachmonus, yesh lochus li yichusoy. Ki ein ho achzorius metzuya elo ba oivdei koichovim. But in Hashem Yisrael, be'etzem nature, rachmonim b'ayshonim u'goyim leichasodim, Avram Avinu commanded his children to do chesed and mishpat. And that's part of the neshama of a yid, the natural neshama of a yid. The only problem is, Yisarvu bagoyim v'yilmedu mimaaseihem. We sometimes give up the neshama and the natural koiches from a neshama of a Yisrael, and we trade them for the personality, the nisyonis, the values from the of the oivdei koichovim. And Mameli, even though it becomes easier maybe for us to this is the default value of a neshama of a yid. And those that protect the values of a yid, the tzura of a yid, the personality of a yid, in those places, dafka, you're going to find the old Yiddish presentlichkeit of Rachmonim b'nei Rachmonim. And that's the Kiddush Hashem over here. A guy does a mitzvah, it's a Kiddush Hashem, he does a mitzvah barabim. But if people, a group does a mitzvah, and we know they're doing this mitzvah specifically because they protected the Yiddish neshama, that's a Kiddush Hashem. Because they protected the Yiddish neshama, therefore they're Rachmonim b'nei Rachmonim. That's the biggest Kiddush Hashem in the world. To see that the old neshama from a Yid is protected from v'yisarvu bagoyim v'yilmedu mimaaseihem, to see what it results in. Have Moshe Klein. Is Moshe Klein an exceptional guy? Of course he's an exceptional guy. Where do you come from, Moshe? Borough Park, right? Yeah. Satmar Borough Park. So, what do you see from Moshe Klein? You can take the Yid out of Satmar, but you can't take Satmar out of the Yid. Our entire community owes a tremendous thanks to Moshe Klein, his wife, the entire group, and everybody that came through in the aftermath of the storm. I'd like to also thank at this point the people who make our shul run. If it wasn't for them, we wouldn't have this celebration tonight. If it wasn't for them, we wouldn't have a Bais Medrash running. We have, Baruch Hashem, a shul that I consider the most successful shul that I know anywhere. Why? We don't have the biggest crowd. We certainly don't have the wealthiest crowd. And those are two reasons, two benchmarks of our success that I'm very, very proud of. But we have a Bais Medrash where there is no politics. You hear that, Captain? We have a shul, a synagogue, no politics. Nobody, there's no politics. Nobody, what? It's hard to believe it exists. There's no politics. Nobody is in charge of anybody else. Nobody nobody gets insulted because somebody else got honored and they didn't get honored. You know all of this childish nonsense that goes on? We have none of that. Zero. Zero. Somebody wants it. Somebody's a wealthy guy comes to our shul. We welcome wealthy people. It's a mitzvah to love wealthy people. Ahavas Yisrael, we love all Jews. All human beings. All human beings. All God's children, right? But if a wealthy person comes to our synagogue and thinks that because he has a lot of money, we're going to give him extra honors, he's going somewhere else. Because it doesn't work that way. In our synagogue, we honor those that deserve honors. We give to those people who deserve to get. And everybody is at peace with each other without any politics whatsoever. We need to thank those people that helped make this happen. First of all the Balabatim and all the Mispalim Bais Medrash of Bayswater, the best group of people in the entire world. Every one of them, every single one of them, everyone. I want to single out our Gaba, Yoinison Orgel. He works so hard. He davens for the Yomid when nobody else wants to daven for the Yomid. He opens the safe when nobody else is there to open the safe. He everything. He lanes when there's nobody there to lane. He's MC by the Melave Malka when there's nobody else wants to be the MC by the Melave Malka. And you know what? You know when people, Captain, listen to me. You know when people, they take these type of positions in synagogues, you know, they get burnt out. How quickly do they get burnt out? Oh, yeah. And they complain, you didn't appoint me, and you didn't appoint me, and while you... How many years are you the Gabbai Yonason? 7 or 8 years, he doesn't get paid a penny. We only take from him. We don't give him anything. He doesn't get paid a penny, but he wants to do it. He wants a PBA card. Besides that, he takes donations. Right. All he wants is a PBA card. It's a labor of love. It's a labor of love by him. And it's a labor of love for everybody. People know that when they come to our synagogue, it's not because they're going to gain a lot of honor. It's not because they're going to be in the newspapers. It's not because they're just coming because it's a place to pray, a place to study, and a place to be a good Jew and a good human being. That's all. And I want to thank everybody in the Bais Medrash. Oh, and especially, by the way, one particular person for helping out for this Melave Malka. Of course, we had Shulam Klein and his gang, and we're going to speak about them more when we mention the Shomrim. But Shaya Shimanovich. Shaya Shimanovich and his Rebbetzin did more for this Melave Malka than I did. They did more for, and they don't even get to speak. They did more for this Melave Malka than anybody else. If it wasn't for them, there wouldn't be a Melave Malka tonight. Designing the invitations, the plaques, making sure, by the way, Moshe, these plaques were originally brown. Until we realized what the decor is inside your house. So then we changed it to black and white. Every little detail was, thank Shai and his Rebbetzin. Every little detail was worked out by them. What? Yes. And also the people who called the Bayswater residents, went through the mailing list to ask people if they're coming. Rachel Schwartz and her friends that did the calls. And Yonis and Orgel for organizing the caller brigade. We Baruch Hashem have a Bais Medrash that's very, there's a lot to be proud of. Enjoy your course after the appetizer. Enjoy your appetizer. The next honorees are going to be the Shomrim. We're going to give them an award. We have a special gift from our Bais Medrash for the Shomrim, which will be presented to them afterwards. And then we're going to see a 15-minute video made, very, very hush of a professional video made by Aviv Stein about the Shomrim and their activities. Thank you very much.
He for sure should be world famous, our Chazen Shmuel Schwartz, for a little niggin.
Zarinu vechaspeinu yahar bekachoil vechakoy chuvim baloilu amavedil amavedil ben kohedesh lechoil chatoy seinu hoyim choil zarinu vechaspeinu yahar bekachoil vechakoy chuvim baloilu Yoim pono kitzel toimer ekru lo keilo lai goimer omar shoimer o so voi ker vegam loilo Yoim pono kitzel toimer ekru lo keilo lai goimer omar shoimer O so voy kervgam loilo Tzidekoscho kaharto voer al chatuvay avoyir tavoyir Ke yoy mes moil, ki yavoyir, ve yahashmuro, valoylu. Cholfu voy nas min chosi, mi yitein men chosi. Miyo bogati v'yan chosi yaske v'chol lailu. Menachenu v'beyodechu v'kacho. Selachnu al kal v'choymen. Selachnu al kal v'choymen. Noi selachnu, nu, selachnu, nu, selachnu al kal v'choymen. Yoim le yoim ya bi ya oyimer velaylu len laylu hamavdil ben koydesh le khoy hatoy seinu hoyim khoy zareinu ve khaspeinu yahar be kakhoy וחכוי חובים בלוילו, בלוילו. מבדיל בין קודש לחוין, חטוי סיינו הויים חוין. זרינו וחספינו יער בכחוין, וחכוי חובים בלוילו.
More.
All right. And now for the main part of the program. The Melave Malka was made to honor the Rockaway Citizen Safety Patrol. Rockaway Citizen Safety Patrol, we call the Shomrim. I don't have words, nor am I qualified, to explain to people how valuable this Shomrim group is to our neighborhood. There's a difference between the Shomrim organization and many other organizations. There's a vote from Reb Chaim Briska. He was talking about the Kanoim. He says there's two types of Kanoim. I'll give you a mashal. He said, let's say you have a cockroach in the house. So nobody likes a cockroach. You have a housewife that kills the cockroach, and she calls an exterminator, and the exterminator also kills the cockroach. So Kanoim, their job is to kill the cockroaches. But what's the difference between the housewife who kills the cockroach and the exterminator who kills the cockroach? The difference, said Reb Chaim, is that the housewife that kills the cockroach, when she sees the cockroach, she's upset, she doesn't want a cockroach. When the exterminator knows there's a cockroach there, he's very happy, because now he has an opportunity to kill the cockroach. That's how he makes his money. So there's some kanoim, said Reb Chaim, that are like the housewife. They know that it's a problem, and they have to step on the cockroach, and that's it. And there are others who, whenever there's somebody to step on, they're happy because now I can be a Kanoim and I can step on the cockroach. The Reb Chaim's Moshel applies to all people that help others. There are two types of people that help. There are people who are an important resource to a community. A community needs them. A community has problems and they help solve communal problems. When they help solve the community's problem, there's a problem, these people are upset. And it bothers them that there's problems in the community. And they do their best to fix the problems. Then there are others who the community is really a resource for them. And when there's a problem in the community, they spring into action. And if it wasn't for the problems of the community, they wouldn't be in business. And they have nothing to do, and they help people because adarabba, the more people are suffering, the better it is for them, because the more they can help and the more money they can collect for their organization, and the better it is for them. And they would be so happy if, rahmana litzlan, more people would have tzoris, and then they would be able to help more people and they'd build themselves up more. I want to tell you, b'didi havayuvda, I saw this. Listen to this, b'einai ra'isi. I was once teaching in a school, it was a kiryev school, it was girls. And you know how they work in the Beis Yankivs where they give chesed hours to the girls, that whoever does more chesed gets more points, you know, per hour. You get a certain points per hour. And there was one of the girls that Nebuch got hit by a truck. And she was in the hospital. Her name was Nina. And the other friends, they went to visit her in the hospital, and they get chesed points for visiting her in the hospital. And one day Nina comes back to school, and she's wearing she has her arm in a sling. I mamish witnessed this. She comes back to school, I'm in a sling, and some other girl comes over to her and says, "Oh no, you're back." I said, "What's the matter?" "I was going to visit you in the hospital, but now I can't get my chesed hours. Where am I going to get my chesed hours? You got better, so it's bad for me because now I can't do a chesed and visit you." There are balei chesed and there are balei chesed. There are balei chesed even if somebody wants to do chesed because he wants the mitzvah. That's not the same as somebody who's bal chesed because he feels that somebody else is in pain. The Gemara says, "Ha'oimer al kantzipor yigir rachamecha meshaskin oisai." If you say that when Hashem said to shoo away the bird before you take the eggs, that Hashem did it because he has rachmonus, you tell him keep quiet, because whenever Hashem made a mitzvah, it's not because of rachmonus, because of humanism, it's because of Hashem's gzeira. Now, I have a question. Does it say anywhere? Forget about Al-Kansipur. What if somebody says, "On Aniye Yisrael Yigiyu Rachamecho"? What if somebody says, not on a Kansipur, not on a bird, on poor people, Oy, it's so great, Hashem, you have Rachmanis on the poor people. Does it say Meshaskin Oysay over there? Why does the Mishnah have to come on to birds? There's a mitzvah to have Rachmanis on other Yidden, to love other Yidden, to do tzedakah, to do chesed, and birds too. So on birds, Meshaskin Oysay, Teretz is, because a bird is taka cheftza de mitzvah. The reason why Hashem made this mitzvah, it's a gzeres hakosev, and you look at the bird the same way you look at a pair of tefillin, a Chanukah menorah. It's a heftzah de mitzvah. If you're going to do a shluach hakein, and the bird flies away or something, or the egg hatches, you have a right to feel bad. You missed the mitzvah. But if you go into the hospital to be mvaka choyle somebody, and the choyle gets better, it's absurd to say, oh yeah, I missed the mitzvah. There you should be happy. Because even though it's all gzeiras melech, but the mitzvah by human beings is to feel for somebody else. A human being is not your heftzah de mitzvah. In the Sefer in Sri Deyesh, it says the reason why there's no bracha on any mitzvah bein odom l'chaveroi. Baruch ato Hashem al kenem el cholam. Asher kedishanu b'mitzvay sov etzivonu al bikr cholam. No such thing. Baruch ato Hashem al kenem el cholam. Asher kedishanu b'mitzvay sov etzivonu al mitzvah tzedakah. No such thing. You know why? He says a lot of reasons. It's a Raj, but it's in the Rishonim. He has a pshat. He says the pshat is because imagine you go to be mavaka choyle somebody and he's sitting there in a bed, nebuch suffering. And you go in front of him and you say, Baruch ato Hashem elkeinu melech haolam, asher kedishanu b'mitzvah tzivonu levaker es hachoyle. How does the guy feel? The guy feels like a thing, like a cheftza de mitzvah. The choyle is not your cheftza de mitzvah. He's not your mitzvah thing. He's not your credit hours. The choyle is a yid who's suffering, and we're not supposed to make him feel like he's a thing. There was once a Rosh Hashiva, it was a Blue Shiva Rebbe. Blue Shiva Rebbe was sick, and it was like the in thing to do for all the chshuvim in Borough Park than to visit the Blue Shiva Rebbe. And there was somebody, Rosh Hashiva, I don't want to say his name because he's not the hero of the story, who calls the Blue Shiva Rebbe and he says, I'm coming to be mvaka choyle you. And the Blue Shiva Rebbe said, stay home. He said, why should I stay home? He says, you care about me. I'm here all these years. What shaykhis do you have with me? Novos. You wake up in the morning, you put on tefillin, you do a mitzvah with your tefillin. Then on Chanukah comes, you do a mitzvah with your menorah. Now you want to do a mitzvah with me. I'm not your esrig. I'm not your chefza de mitzvah. I'm a human being. There are some organizations, Rabbosai, that they come, and the community is a resource for them. Like the exterminator, there's a problem, and they step on the cockroach. It's a gewaldig thing. We need exterminators. But the exterminator lives off cockroaches. And there are people who live off problems of yenim. Maybe you gain money, maybe you gain chesed hours, maybe you gain covid, maybe you gain, it's your parnas, maybe you, whatever. Even if you gain mitzvahs, the mitzvah is to feel bad that somebody else is suffering. And a chesed organization, you know what the goal of a chesed organization is? To shut themselves down. They should pray every day that nobody should need them. A chesed organization should pray every day, Hashem, please, give us no business and we should be shut down. I once asked the head of the Chevra Kaddish in Queens, what does he have in mind when he's mispal for Parnosa on Rosh Hashanah? He said a good answer. He told me a good answer. He said, I pray that all people, that all Yidden that have to be nifter min hashamayim should all have a Yiddish kvura. I'll have more business than I can handle. It was a good answer. But the kasha was a question. A chesed organization, a real Baal chesed prays to HaKadosh Baruch Hu that he should be put out of business tomorrow. There should be nobody to do chesed for. Chazonish said this. Chazonish said, here's the case. You're in shul Friday night, and there's a guy who you see needs a place to eat. His car broke down, he's in shul, whatever it is. You want to go invite him. Hachnosas orchim. But somebody else beats you to it. Somebody else is machnes orchim first. How do you feel? Do you feel bad because you missed the mitzvah, missed the opportunity? Or do you feel good because the guy doesn't need you anymore? Says the Chazinish, he's supposed to feel good because the guy doesn't need you anymore. These shomrim came to this community not because they wanted to start an organization, and not because they needed the community as a resource for them, and not because people needed parnasa and the Yungalites had nothing to do and they had no jobs and they decided we're going to open a shomrim and now we're all going to make money, we're going to have parnasa. None of this. I know Shulam Klein, he works, where's Shulam, where is he? Shulam Klein works very, very hard, a whole day, mamish a whole day. I know what time when he leaves in the morning and I know what time he comes home at night, and he has, believe me, he has a lot to do. These people are here only for us. They're not here for them. A Baal Chesed is supposed to be here for Yenim, not for Zich. And even if Zich gets mitzvahs, and even if Zich is entitled to Zich, but a real Baal Chesed is somebody that wants to be put out of business, believe me, these Shomrim would be the happiest people in the world if there would be no crime in our community, and they'd have nothing to do a whole night with their patrols. And for this, they deserve our undying gratitude, because they really are here for us and for no other reason. And now I would like to call upon them. Four of them, one of them has the flu and he's not here, but I'm going to call upon him anyway, amongst the four leaders of the Shomrim, to accept the plaque that we prepared for them. The second member of the Shomrim that I'm calling up is Shulam Klein. Now, before I mention something about Shulam Klein, I want to tell you a little background over here. Shulam Klein kept telling me, don't say anything about me, don't say anything about me. And he wouldn't tell me anything about him. He says to me, do you know who really, really, really deserves all the credit for my work? Is my wife, Rifki. He tells me, you don't understand. It was Hanukkah. And what do people do during Hanukkah? They tzin licht and the whole family is around, right? Mrs. Klein was home alone with the kids because Shulam was out protecting us. And it's her sacrifice that allowed Shulam to do that. And Shulam is telling me that he gets no credit. She's the one that stayed home alone with the kids on Hanukkah. And she's the one that stuck at home. And she's the one that really, really provides the sacrifice. She's the one that gets all the credit for everything I do. In the words of Chazal, what Shulam wanted to say, Sheli v'shelchem shelo. Now, this is not the only area where Mrs. Klein is a tremendous asset to the community. Our mikveh would be a shambles still if it wasn't for her. Every day she's mamish busy over there taking care of it with the designs and the tiles and all the things that she does. Shulam is telling me the whole time, don't say anything about me, she deserves all the credit. So I'm a tricky rabbi. I want to say something about Shulam, but he's not telling me anything, so what do? I call up Shulam's wife behind his back, and I say, Mrs. Klein, I got to talk about Shulam. Tell me stuff to say. And she says, Shulam, he gets all the credit in the world. I could mamish write a book. Everything is Shulam. And she tells me about how when they were first married, listen to this. We spoke about Moshe Klein when he was engaged. He was busy with that. Okay. Engaged, Mela. Then you get married. Now you're newlywed, Shana Rishayna, right? What do Shana Rishayna couples spend their time doing? Be together, whatever. Every night after they were married, Shulam and his wife were out patrolling the streets of Williamsburg together in the car. Till 4, 5, 6 in the morning. Now I know why your Shulam bias is so good. Mamish, he doesn't move a drop from his wife, him and his wife, all together, the whole year. So they were patrolling nightly in Shulam. You know, some people, there's something called a tfiyas ayin, where some people have a talent to look at something and to see just through an observation, just through a passing observation, to notice things that other people don't notice. So Shulam's in the car, this is the middle of the night, and he says to his wife, see that guy? He's out here for no good reason. He has no reason to be out here. we're going to follow him. So Shulam follows the guy, and sure enough, the guy steals a bicycle, the guy breaks into a house. It's unbelievable. Shulam has Azan nose for crooks like nobody else that I've ever known. I'm getting worried while he's davening in our shul, like, what's he finding over there? But Shulam Klein, it's not only catching crooks. He once convinced somebody, some girl, not to commit suicide. There was a girl who wanted to commit suicide. So who do they call? Called the Shomrim. And he convinced her not to. Shalom bias issues, they call Shulam Klein. He's mamish like a ganza Rebbe of Bayswater, Admor Reb Shulam. We want him to accept the reward also. He's number two. The next one, who unfortunately has the flu, he caught the flu today and he was unable to be with us, but his wife is here and I want her to hear this, Elkanah Edelman. Elkanah Edelman's wife was fully aware and supportive of the fact that he was in the office 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. He used to spend all night preparing the generators for the next day. There are a bunch of generators, people that needed the generators. Where are they going to come from? Where are they going to go? So once the day comes, then you have to start. Now, there are different places to get generators. Moshe Klein will explain that to you. But Elkanah all night was making cheshbonis. Where's the generators going to come from? Where are the generators going to go? He stood in the office the whole time. There were people who were burning, who Rahman al-Itzlan were trapped in a fire. He was the one that called Hatzalah. And you know, usually in a flood, the biggest sakana is not the water. The biggest sakana is the electricity. Everybody knows that. Who do you think, I walked out in my house after the storm, right on my street in Bay 28th Street, there's this wire that's hanging down. It's still hanging down, by the way. I don't know if it's live or not, but right in front of the house, there's mamsha wire hanging down, okay? Waiting for the cockroaches so we could, it's like that. But there were live wires all over the place. Who do you think went and risked his life? He's skilled, so it's not really risked his life. But who spent the time and the skill to secure the live wires to make sure that they're not going to electrocute anybody? It was Elkanah Edelman. After he served, and talking about caring about somebody else, after the people were saved from the burning house, okay, what does an exterminator type a Baal Chesed do? Fine, they were saved from the burning house. Let's find another burning house and save somebody else. Well, there are worse things that a person could think of, but that's still not V'yazdavtzazayin. V'yazdavtzazayin is what Elkanah Edelman thought after the people came out of the house. He was worried. Everybody was so happy they were saved. Elkanah was unhappy. Where are these people going to sleep tonight, he said. He was the one that made sure that the people not only were saved, not only the heroics, but the little stuff, like where are the people who were saved from the fire going to sleep. And he's unable to be here tonight, unfortunately, but his wife is here. I want her to shep all the nachas to understand that the entire community is unspeakably grateful to your husband, and we are unspeakably indebted to him and to you for the services that you have provided for our community and the care that you give to us. I don't know, Elkanah, I don't remember when Elkanah's parents here lived in Bayswater. I don't remember how old Elkanah was or if he was a little kid or what, but I remember those days. I don't know Bechlal, if as he was growing up, or when you married him, you would imagine, or he would imagine, that he and you would be such heroes in such a small amount of time. Shigo Michael El Choyl, and the fourth one is Mr. Yaakov Gate. Mr. Yaakov Gate from the Shomrim of Flatbush. If it wasn't for the support of him and people like him, but primarily him, we wouldn't have a Shomrim in Far Rockaway. We wouldn't have people being saved in Bell Harbor. We wouldn't have that. It's because of the efforts of Yaakov Gate that we have a Shomrim. He doesn't get any heroic rewards. Nobody comes over to him and pats him on the back over here in Bayswater. Nobody even knows he's totally behind the scenes, but if not for him, we wouldn't have a Shomrim. We owe the entire Shomrim organization to Yaakov Gate. Now all four or three of you, please come up and accept the award. Jason is going to thank the Olam for the award, and then we're going to see the video about the Shomrim's activities during the hurricane.